Our skeletal system is one of the most critical systems crucial for our health and quality of life. However, injury often happens and our bones can repair themselves in a very sophisticated way. The process is similar to other tissue repair systems, which start with bleeding and coagulation. The coagulation happens with the help of platelets and fibrin proteins to stop the bleeding, and it acts as the provisional extracellular matrix. At the same time, the first line of defense, neutrophils and M1 macrophages, release inflammatory cytokines such as TNF-alpha, interleukin-1 and interleukin-6, which make positive feedback loops to increase inflammation. The purpose of this phase is to clean the dead tissues and fight infections. Inflammation is a very demanding process and requires a high level of metabolic activity which consumes a lot of oxygen. So the level of oxygen in this area gets lower gradually and makes the environment hypoxic. The body tackles this problem by creating new blood vessels to support the tissue with oxygen and nutrients. This tissue with new blood vessels is called the granulation tissue. Then, M1 macrophages transform into the M2 types. They secrete anti-inflammatory cytokines such as interleukin-4, interleukin-10, and TGF-beta, which start the repairing phase. After that, the fibroblasts activate and secrete a fibrous matrix that gradually replaces the granulation tissue. Then, mesenchymal stem cells migrate from the bone marrow, periosteum and endosteum to the site of injury and make new cells such as osteoblasts and chondrocytes, which are responsible for making the bone tissue. These cells can make bone tissue in two different ways, intramembranous ossification and endochondral ossification. During the bone healing process, four specific repair environments are formed depending on the location of the bone injury: cancellous bone area, cortical bone area, periosteum area, and the surrounding soft tissue. The cancellous and cortical bone areas are repaired by endochondral ossification, while the other two use intramembranous ossification. Now let's talk about them specifically. Intramembranous ossification starts with the signaling molecules called bone morphogenic proteins, which increase the expression of RUNX2 in mesenchymal stem cells. Expression of this factor induces their differentiation into osteoblasts. These cells make the bone matrix, which consists of collagen type 1. During inflammation, since the cell's activity increases, the cells face a lower level of oxygen. When osteoblasts sense the lack of oxygen, they express the HIF1 factor. When the level of HIF1 increases in osteoblasts, they release a factor called vascular endothelial growth factor, or VEGF, which causes the migration of endothelial cells to make blood vessels for increasing oxygen and nutrients. Osteoblasts continue producing bone matrix until they trap inside the matrix and differentiate into osteocytes. Finally, the mesenchymal cells around the mineralized matrix condense and make periosteum. Endochondral ossification starts with two signaling factors called TGF-beta and bone morphogenic proteins 2, which stimulate mesenchymal stem cells to express SOX9. Expressing this factor makes the mesenchymal stem cells differentiate into chondrocytes. Then, the parathyroid hormone-related protein stimulates the chondrocyte to secrete a matrix consisting of collagen type 2. The fibroblast growth factor decreases the proliferation of chondrocytes in the central area, and they become hypertrophic. These hypertrophic cells release collagen type 10 and calcium phosphate granules, which become coarse for the growth of apatite microcrystals. At the same time, the chondrocytes at the edge of the condensation area increase RUNX2 expression and differentiate into osteoblasts, which secrete collagen type 1 and make the final bone matrix. The hypertrophic chondrocytes and hypoxic osteoblasts secrete VEGF to induce blood vessels formation. This is the primary ossification center, and osteoblasts make the final bone tissue. Secondary ossification centers are created at both ends of long bones. However, some chondrocytes are stored in the area between the primary and secondary ossification centers and make the growth plates. After birth, these sites are responsible for the growth of long bones by endochondral ossification. Simply, it means they help us to get taller after our birth. In the next video, I'm gonna dive into more complicated stuff about the treatments of bone fractures. But until then, thank you for watching.